The Upanishad series. This is again a question. Sometimes when the question comes, these have to be responded. How can one distinguish between enlightened self-love and egomania? Outwardly the two look the same. Enlightened self-love and egomania, what's the difference between the two? As you traverse through the life's roads, do not allow your self-confidence, atma-vishwas, shatter in any way. The moment your self-confidence is shattered, you go into belief system. Atma-vishwas ki kami, the lack of self-confidence, is the root of andh-vishwas, the blind trust. The lack of self-confidence in oneself is the root for blind trust. What's the difference between enlightened self-love and egomania? The distinction is subtle but very clear. It is not difficult. Indeed, it is subtle but not difficult. If you have egomania, you will create more and more misery for you. More and more misery for you. Misery will indicate that you are ill. Egomania is a disease. It is cancer of the soul. The world has its origin in ego. And then it gets further accentuated because of mania or obsession that ego sense creates. First you have ego, and when your ego creates a mania, it becomes egomania. It will make you more and more tense, will make you more and more uptight, will not allow you to relax at all. It will drive you towards insanity. Self-love is just the opposite of egomania. In self-love, there is no self. Only love exists. In egomania, there is no love. Only self is there. Therefore, in self-love, you will start becoming more and more relaxed. A person who loves himself is totally relaxed. And one of the most important criteria, you cannot love the other unless you love yourself. If you do not have the energy, how can you help the other? If you do not have the money, how can you give a donation to someone? Love first has to be experienced within, and then you can share it with the other. Love is sharing. It is the outcome of inner harmony, oneness, and bliss. The moment you are overflowing with joy, bliss, for no reason, there is a happiness. You look at the child, he has not gained anything, no laurels, no degrees, no, he has not won any of those kind of things which normally make you happy. Yet still child is happy. His happiness is coming from somewhere else. Self-love is just opposite of egomania. In self-love, there is no self. Only love exists. You are overflowing. You have discovered the source of love deep within you. Now your cup is brimmed. What will happen? It will overflow. Love is overflow of your spontaneous harmony and oneness. In egomania, there is no love. Only self is there. And in self-love, you will start becoming more and more relaxed. A person who loves himself is totally relaxed, and remember, loving oneself is knowing the art, is discovering the source of bliss, happiness, source of love within. A person who loves himself, he will be relaxed. This is a simple thing. Normally, whatsoever happens, we do things out of compulsion. But a man of self-love does not do anything out of compulsion, instead out of his love. Love for those who are around. It happened one day, one of our family relative and friend, she wanted to come to make the arrangement for the cooking class, and she picked up her daughter. She called me that she will not be able to come because it is late and she has to go home. There is traffic and her daughter is hungry. I said, you are coming to make the arrangement for cooking class, come. I will make food for you. He said, you will make food for me, uncle? I said, yes. I said, what do you want? I said, whatever you wish, I will make for you. This is out of self-love. That you want to share your happiness, your joy with the others, there is no compulsion. Nobody has forced me to do that. But many times it happens, guests come to your place. You feel burdened. No. It should not be that way. And I said to her, I said, by the time you come, the food will be ready. I said, what do you want? I said, you had seen the food network. There is a cook who gives a 20 minutes meal. I will give you a 12 minutes meal. By the time you reach home by me, you will get the meals. So we prepared a dish. I prepared a dish of paneer and naan. I had it and it's ready. By the time she came, the food was ready. The person will be relaxed. Whatsoever he does is out of sheer joy, out of overflowing. To love somebody else may create a little tension. The other may not be always in tune with you, but you are always in tune with you. The other may have his or her ideas. The other is a different world altogether. There is every possibility of collision, clash. There is every possibility of storm and thunder because the other is a different world. There is always a subtle struggle going on. On the contrary, when you love yourself, there is nobody else. There is no conflict. There is pure silence, tremendous delight. You are alone, and alone is a beautiful word. If you give a synthesis, it is all one. When there is all oneness, everything within you is harmonious, like an orchestra, completely tuned, all the musical instruments, various organs of your body, various chakras, psychocenters are in tune with one another, then you are alone. Nobody disturbs you. There is a very beautiful word, agriculture. We are agrarian economy. And agriculture is a beautiful word. You know how beautiful word is this? Agriculture comes from the two words, agriculture. When you agree with all the cultures, you are an agriculturist. So start agreeing with all the cultures and you return to the agrarian economy. You are alone, nobody disturbs you, the other is not needed at all, and to me, a person who has become capable of such deep love towards himself becomes capable of loving others as well. You cannot love yourself. If you cannot love yourself, how can you love others? So the first criteria of love is experiences within, and then it starts loving yourself. It must first happen at close quarters or within you. Only then it will spread its branches, its roots towards others. People try to love others, but they are not at all aware that they have not even loved themselves. How can you love others? Indeed, something that you do not have, you cannot share. You do not have the money in your wallet and you want to give a beggar a dollar. You can give to others only that which you have already with you. So the first and the foremost basic step towards love is love of oneself. Begin to love yourself first, and then you have discovered the source of love within, and then it will start overflowing. You cannot contain it. So the first and the foremost basic step towards love is the love of oneself, but it has no self in it. It is pure love overflowing. Let me further explain this to you. The I arises only in contrast to thou, I and you. This is duality, you and me. And the very deep understanding of the Hindu Vedanta, the Hindu Advait means the duality. A means none, Dvait means duality when duality does not exist. I exist only because of you, thou. I and thou exist together. And I can exist in two dimensions. One dimension is I, it, you and your house. You and your car, you and your money, you and your wife, I, it. When there is this I of I, it, your I is almost like a commodity. It is not consciousness. It is fast asleep and snoring. Your consciousness is not there. You are just like things. A thing emits things. Part of your house, part of your furniture, part of your money. Have you ever watched it? A man who is too greedy about money, by and by he starts having the qualities of the money. He becomes just money. He loses spirituality completely and he is no more a spirit. He is reduced to a commodity thing. If you love money, you will become like money. If you love your house, by and by you will become material. Whatsoever you love, you become that. Love is alchemical. Never love the wrong thing because it will transform you. Nothing is as transforming as love is. Love something which can raise you higher to higher altitudes. Love is something which is beyond you. It can take you to the highest peak. That is the whole understanding and effect of religion. It gives you a love object like God, so there is no way to fall down. One has to rise. One sort of I exists as I it, and this type of I exists as I and thou. When you love a person, another type of I arises in you, I, thou. You love a person, you become a person. Many times you would have heard people talking about, I love my car. I love this. This is where the I becomes an the. This is I it. It is reduced to an object. But what about self-love? There is no it and there is no thou. I disappears because I cannot exist in two contexts, it and thou. I is the figure, it, and thou function as the field. When field disappears, the I disappears. When you are left all alone, you are, but you do not have I. You do not feel any I. You are simply a deep emptiness. No I. Ordinarily we say I am. In that state, when you are in deep love with yourself, I disappears, then there will only be emptiness. Sometimes when people are posting the messages on Facebook, they do not use I am, they use M as a short. But somewhere in the deep subconscious, it is a reminder. It is happening unconsciously. I disappears, then there will only be emptiness or pure existence or pure being there. It will fill you with tremendous bliss. It will make you a celebration, a rejoicing. There will be no problem in distinguishing between them. If you are getting more and more miserable, then you are on the trip of being an egomaniac. If you are getting more and more miserable, remember, then you are on the trip of being an egomaniac. If you are becoming more and more tranquil, silent, happy, collected, together, then you are on another trip, the trip of self-love. When you are on the trip of ego, you will become destructive to others because ego tries to destroy the Tao, the other. If you are moving towards self-love, ego will disappear. And when ego disappears, you allow the others to be him or her. You give total freedom. If you do not have any ego, you cannot create an imprisonment for the other you love. You give him total freedom. You cannot create a cage. You allow the other to be an eagle soaring in the high heavens. You allow the other to be him or her. You give total freedom. Love gives total freedom. Indeed, love is total freedom. Indeed, love is freedom. Indeed, freedom for you and freedom for the object of your love. Ego is bondage, and ego can play very deep tricks with you. Deep tricks with you. It is very cunning, and subtle are its ways. It can pretend to be self-love, but it is not. The ego is very cunning. It is very self-justifying and self-rationalizing. If you are not very alert, it can start hiding itself behind itself, behind self-love. The very word self will become a protection for it. It can say, I am your self. It can change its weight, it can change its height, it can change its name too. And because it is just an idea, there can be no problem about it. Ego can become small and big instantaneously. It is just your fantasy. Be very careful. If you really want to grow in love, much carefulness will be needed. Each step has to be taken in deep alertness. So ego cannot find any loophole to hide behind. Your real self is neither I nor thou. It is beyond the two. It is neither you nor the other. Your real self is transcendental. What you call I is your real self. I is imposed on reality. When you call somebody you, you are not addressing the real self of the other. Again, you have imposed a label on it. When all the labels are taken away, the label of I and thou, then the real self remains. And the real self is as much yours as it is others. The real self is one. That is why we go on saying that we participate in each other's being. We are members of each other. Our real reality is God. That is a participation, a celebration, oneness. We may be like icebergs floating in the ocean, and they appear to be separate. But once we melt, nothing will be left except totality. Definitions will disappear. Limitations will disappear, and the iceberg will not be there. It will become the part of the ocean. The moment we become part of the ocean, ego is the iceberg. Allow it to melt. And the moment the ego melts, melt it in deep love, so it disappears and you become part of the ocean. You become the part of the ocean when all the icebergs of ego have melted. What will remain? The ocean. And that ocean, that oceanic presence is awakening. And we gave it a name, God, but by different names. The truth is neither I nor you. You and I is an imposition on the vastness of the truth. I is false and you is false as well. Both words I and you are utilitarian, useful in the world. It will be difficult to manage the world without the use of these words I and you. It is good to use them whenever needed, but they are just devices to live into the world. In reality, there is neither you nor I. Something, someone, some energy exists with no limitations, no boundaries. Out of it we came, and into it we dissolve, disappear again one day. Out of that oneness, you came into existence, a limitless something, someone, some energy exists without any limitations and boundaries. Out of it we came, and into it we disappear one day again. A drop, when it evaporates from the surface of the ocean, it becomes cloud. Then it showers and again continues its journey towards the merger with the ocean, dissolves it. A seed blossoms, sprouts, becomes a plant, allows myriads of many flowers to grow on its surface. Then a flower blossoms, spreads its beauty and fragrance. Then it withers away, drops the leaves. The process of decomposition begins. But process of decomposition is the continuation of another cycle of life. When this decomposed leaves will become the manure to nourish and nurture the plant again in preparation for the next. Your life lived that way is a preparation for the new foliage, new spring to come. You had lived your spring through the flowers of love. Now allow these flowers of love to nourish and nurture for the beginning of the new season. Only this much for this morning. Thank you for being to this live broadcast every Saturday, Sunday and Monday. Eastern time is 6 a.m. to 7 a.m. Sometimes the talk is shorter one. Sometimes it is an hour, but we keep an hour for the talk to take place. And during from 20th to 27th, I will be out of Trinidad on my trip to United States for various programs. Those will be broadcast live. I do not have the complete itinerary and I do not know what the topics are, but I know there are certain concerts at Center for Light, then certain are at George Washington University. What is the difference between, what is the relation between religion, meditation, music and dance?